Hello and welcome to Dance Mum Alive. We're at our first session and we are about to do our first webinar with Dr. Steve Ingham. I'm Lucy McCrudden. How do I introduce Steve succinctly? Because he has an amazing, illustrious career. He's one of the leading figures in sport and one of the world's leading performance scientists. His experience as a physiologist to Dame Jessica Ennis-Hill during her success winning Olympic silver and the world title postnatally will provide an extraordinarily inspirational and valuable insight into the supportive training methods, enabling her to succeed at the highest level as a parent and athlete. Steve is steeped in high performance and has been an integral part of the development of Britain as an Olympic superpower. He's provided support to over 1,000 athletes, and over 200 of those have achieved world or Olympic medal success and include some of the world's greatest athletes, such as Sir Stephen Redgrave and Sir Matthew Pinsent. And last year, James Cracknell in the boat race. And it was a pleasure to see Steve pop up on BBC and be interviewed there. So without further ado, because there is just so much to talk about, Pia will make you the host. And Steve, take it away.
Thank you so much, Lucy. Absolute pleasure and delight to be with you all today. I hope you're all well, first and foremost. And I'm excited to share with you some thoughts and some reflections from some time working with Jessica Ennis-Hill. So in terms of the context for this, I want to make sure that you have your expectations leveled straight away. I'm not a medical doctor, I'm a physiologist, a sports scientist, and I've spent the last 25 years or so working in elite sport. And so there's a particular viewpoint around the support of an elite athlete. They get an awful lot of resources and support. So modern elite athletes will have a support team. Some call them an entourage, I think it's a bit harsh. But the idea is that the specialists are taking care of their preparation and their performance. And part of this is that declaring that whilst I'm not an expert in pregnancy specifically, Jess was pregnant towards the end of her career. And so that for us meant that we had to make sure that we were harnessing applied sports science and performance science to support her. So whilst my specialism isn't that, you often encounter situations in elite sport where you think, things have changed. For example, an injury, something that might have, a young athlete who might have moved away from home for the first time that is experiencing some mental stresses. And so you have to adapt and learn. And that's probably a core theme of my work with Jess, is that you have to adapt and learn all the way through, because there's often no textbook of supporting an elite athlete, and there's certainly no textbook on supporting an elite athlete who has a pregnancy and a birth in the midpoint of their career. So Jess probably doesn't need an awful lot of introduction. What I'll do is I'll give you a brief introduction to me. I'll introduce Jess. But part of this is explaining the context of who Jess is and what she's accomplished. And so I'll talk a little bit about the journey towards London, and primarily because a lot of the principles upon which we established her performance capability and a success became undone with a pregnancy, and we had to completely revise those. So I'll explain a little bit about the pre-birth Jess, the athlete Jess first and foremost. And then I'll explain a little bit about how things changed, reframed mentally, physically, and how Jess presented to us to say, okay, I want to win again, but I'm a mum first and foremost. And that was what we were driving to and working towards. I will say that Jess has got some incredible resources now. She's really lent into this as a concept, and supporting mothers through pregnancy and through postpartum. So have a look at Jessica. Jenny's Fitness is her new system. So she's become a real ambassador and a bastion for this. I'll provide some links in the chat for you as we go. I run a podcast called Supporting Champions, and Jess and I chatted through her career, of which some of the discussion was around her birth of her first child, Reggie. So I'll provide you with some links for that. So context for me, sport and performance scientist, physiologist by trade, supporting athletes through the last 25 years, when we've gone from a system that was really rubbish, 1996, won gold medal at the Atlanta Games, all the way through to being a world superpower, success of London 2012, but second on the medal table in Olympics and Paralympics, beating mega nations such as China. And part of that is the application of objective observation, systematic support, utilising science to enhance performance. So 200 athletes that I've supported have stood on top of the world or Olympic podium. And from that, you can start to pick out some of the key trends that really work for athletes and really don't. Part of that also is that I led the science operation for the British system at the London Games and the Rio Olympics, the last Games. So that's supporting the whole team. So that's the psychologists, the nutritionists, biomechanists. So athletes don't lack for that type of support. And what I'd hopefully be able to do is draw out some of the principles that you'll be able to utilise today that are beyond the resource set too. Disclaimer, I've never been an elite athlete, I never will be. My hopes and dreams of becoming Olympic 100 meter champion were dashed quite quickly when I was quite good at school, I was quite good at the regional level, then I got to national level. I was like, okay, there's a lot of fast people. and that curiosity of thinking, I'm not as quick as you, but maybe I could learn how I could improve my performance. And that led me to studying sports science. That led me to trying all sorts of different regimes on myself, applying science to other performers. And I still didn't win, but I learned a lot along the way, which I could find actually started to really help other people. So I'm not world-class at really anything. Actually, I am world-class at hyperventilating, but I don't know how useful that is. So it's a bit of a shame that I can't actually monetize that. Anyway, so I haven't got a gold medal to show at the end to say, I know because I've achieved. My job has been in support of other people to success. So if you don't know Jessica Ennis, she's now Jessica Ennis Hill. She's now Dame Jessica Ennis Hill. So we have to curtsy when we see Jess. The context here is that Jess was the face of the London 2012 Games. So the pressure upon Team Jenis, as the press called us, was quite high. The pressure on Jess was even higher. So this is the painting on the side of the Heathrow runway that welcomed every athlete, every coach, every official, every spectator to the London Games. And so for Jess to be able to perform under the spotlight of expectations, when they're looking around and they're looking for a figurehead, Jess was the one that was chosen. So this is our slightly awkward way, our slightly awkward British way of trying to intimidate the opposition. Welcome to our turf, sorry. Would you like a cup of tea? So this is Jess being put forward to becoming that figurehead. My work with Jess started back in 2004. So Jess here is a young athlete at the World Junior Championships. And Jess had led the heptathlon, the seven events for five of those seven. And then the javelin came in and then the 800 meters and she went down. She went from first and to fifth and to sixth. And Tony Minicello, her super charismatic, slight mafia boss edge coach to him, but he would be proud to say that, an amazing coach. I'd worked with him for several years, and he came in and said, look, Steve, I'd love you to help support Jess, particularly with the 800 metres. So that was my specialism at the time. So the middle distance events. And it's difficult to put into context just the transformation that Jess underwent from being a junior athlete through to being at her prime at London Olympics, the physicality that she was able to demonstrate. And Tony said to me when he first met me, first talked about Jess, he said, I've got this kid, I think she's going to be quite good, which was like the biggest understatement ever. She was extraordinary. And to watch somebody who's about 5'4", 5'5", that sort of height, not particularly statuesque, jump over 1.96 meters is a phenomenal thing to see. So specifically, the reactivity, the ability to bounce off the floor is off the scale. Before the heptathlon, I was drawn in for the last event, the 800 meters. But prior to that, you have the hurdles, which is a sprint event with stuff in the way. You have to jump over a high thing. That's the high jump. You have to throw a heavy thing. That's the shot put. You have to do a sprint event around a corner. That's the 200 meters. Then you get the night off. So that's the first day. You jump into a sand pit as far as you can. You throw a spear as far as you can. Then you run around in a circle twice. So that's the heptathlon. At the end of that, you have the honour of saying that you are the best female athlete in the world, all round. And so the 800 metres is the last event, and it often decides the medals. It doesn't always, but it often decides the medals. So it's not the biggest point scorer, but it can shift and change the event. So the biggest point scorers are the hurdles, the high jump, the long jump. You have to be able to sprint, you have to be able to jump. And I've been brought in to do something different. It's not about the quick speed, it's not about the jumping ability, it's about enduring and stamina. And so now we've got a potential conflict. And this is relevant to Jess later on. So she's a sprint and power athlete, explosive. So she can generate a lot of force, but then she tires quite quickly. And that's the sprint characteristic. Whereas the endurance athletes, so like Chris Froome on the right here, they don't generate an awful lot of force, but they can go all day, absolutely go all day. And we need to create a bit of that ability to endure. The trouble is that the ability to endure, if you develop that, if you train for a marathon, for example, your strength weakens. If you train for weights and power, then your endurance weakens. So it's a seesaw. You can't have both at an optimum level. So that creates a real conflict for us. And so I was trying to infuse endurance training in for a power athlete. And what that meant was that we were quite conflicted as a team. So this is the support team that someone like Jess would have behind her. I was one of the first on the team because of this 800 meter issue. So was the javelin coach, so was the physiotherapist. Physios are the most common service in elite sport. And the team starts to expand. And we can't really get a consensus around what is it we need to be doing for Jess. Should we be covering off this weakness, this 800 meters, or should we be focusing on power? And so one of the tactics you've got to make sure that you're working on, when you have no formula for this, when you have challenges within teams, when you have conflicting thoughts and decisions, is to talk. It sounds really blindingly obvious, but there's no reference book for this. It's a case of saying, Jess, what do you think? What are your thoughts? How should we approach what you do? So this is Jess in the laboratory. We undertook some testing information that could inform the process. But reality is that the testing, the numbers, the data often confirmed just with real objectivity what we already knew about Jess. The coach already knew what she was good at, what she wasn't good at. Now, one of the things that is relevant later on in the discussion is what Jess was doing every day. So what do you normally do? What's a heptathlon training look like? And so one example is that they don't put javelin and high jump next to each other because they're using the same muscle movements. But this is just a graphical representation of the sessions that Jess was doing. And I said, why do you train like that? And they had some good answers, like the high jump and the hurdles. And they said, well, I don't know, we've just always trained like that. That's what other people did before us. And so now I'm thinking, okay, there's a potential here for you to improve your 800 meter performance without me changing the training program radically by simply doing this. So Jess, you've got these training blocks, but you're doing sessions back to back. What if we could just move them further apart? You're going to get more rest in between those, and that means that you're going to adapt and change and train more effectively. You're going to just get more return from your training. And so Jess is challenged in a slightly different way. They've got to change their routine, do something that they've never done before, but equally, she's got to be a bit more organized. She's got to make sure that she either travels back home, so there's more travel time, or she brings packed lunch, she finds somewhere that she can to eat and rest and sleep and get recovery. So just putting more space between the training regime, which gave Jess quite a big improvement in performance. One slight aside was that idea started to build. So for Jess, we went from you've done your first ever heptathlon at a major competition through to planning this 7 years in advance. And all the way through, we were working on a regime to improve Jess's recovery between the events. And so this idea of recovery really started to build. So this is Jess in the Olympic Stadium, and this is the plan that Jess followed. Importantly for you to recognize is that these ideas and these plans, the details are not important, but this gave Jess a real focus in the stadium. As I've got something to hold, and this gives me focus that I can deliver upon. When I asked Jess, how would you like this to run? She said, I want your top ideas. I don't want 100 things. I don't want this to have to be a big project management exercise. And she also said, I want a plan A, plan B, and plan C. Is that when you get into the stadium, you never know what it's going to be like. You never know whether you can recover properly. You never know whether you've got good shower facilities, good catering, for example, and things can change. And so she said, what I don't want is one single plan that means that I'm fixed on that because I want things to adapt and change. So this is an important approach that Jess was starting to culture and learn already, the flexible, adaptable approach to her preparation and her performance was really key. And this is important from the point of view that athletes often become, I wouldn't say this for Jess necessarily, often become closed-minded as they get more successful. So you start thinking, right, well, I'm now world champion. That's the regime that I'm going to now do forever, as opposed to thinking, that's what got me to world champion, but that's not necessarily going to get me to Olympic champion, nor does it get me to Olympic champion again. So as you get older, as you change, as your recovery changes, as life gets in the way. So this is a plan that Jess delivered. This is the Rio plan, actually, for the Games. I'd like to show you a little video now, just as a bit of a distraction, a bit of an indulgence. So this is Jess doing the first event, the hurdles. It's a really important event. And the context for this is that Jess, normally the heptathlon is the first thing in the morning. The hurdles is the first event. It's really early and no one turns up. In London, rather than 30 coaches, 30 athletes, 30 pigeons, there was 80,000 people that turned up to greet Jess. So that's the first thing to notice, this enormous crowd. 12.54 seconds won the individual hurdles event, so keep an eye on the clock. And lastly, you'll hear her name call out and you'll see her take a big breath in. So that's just some features that we knew she had to take a big breath in to catch the stress of the announcement and then go and perform. So this is just a complete indulgence of Jess performing her first event.
This last year, Chernova, so watch out for her. One of the very talented Russians, Eastern Europeans have produced time and time again. Well, Sarah Lurtz of Belgium got a best of 13.06 this season, so she's in very good form indeed.
Jess is in lane 8.
The local crowd. A nervous look on the face of a young woman with a huge... Side is Fountain of the United States, and Ennis coming through along with Zelinka on the far side. Ennis is going to take this. Ennis wins it. Zelinka second, Fountain third, 12.54. That's astonishing. That's the best in the world. That is a fantastic performance. 12.54 is a world-class performance, a world best, and that is the way to start. There's no question about that.
Okay, so Jess is up and running literally and flying. She would have won the individual hurdles, and there's a sense of confidence that she has on the start line to be able to perform, because if you have a bad hurdles, you have a bad heptathlon. So long story short, this meant that Jess was on the front foot and could almost communicate, well, you're gonna have to now catch me up. So Jess delivered the stadium Super Saturday. I'm sure you remember it well, back in 2012. So I'll skip the step of the victory, the wonderful moment of her crossing the finish line, becoming Olympic champion. This was for Jess. This was 7 years in the making. We started to realise 2005. You're going to be at your peak in 2012. And so we had time to think concertedly about her performance. But for her, for the team, this was her Everest. This was the moment of thinking, well, actually, that's going to be my peak. After that, is it going to get any better? And so one of the things that you have to make sure you're supporting an athlete in a meaningful, caring, trusting way throughout their journey, because athletes don't care what you know until they know that you care. And so that's important from the point of view of having strong discussions throughout the journey. So this is Jess down the bottom here. This is the Commonwealth Games. This is her first breakthrough moment. She then went to the World Championships of 2007. She came fourth. She probably should be upgraded to third. There's some dodgy results that day. She then took the title, the World Championship title, in 2009. That was an important moment where suddenly she becomes a real focus for the press. And obviously the moment that she took the gold in London. And so this is Jess's progression through the time. So these are her heptathlon point scoring. You can see she's made amazing progress through that time and hitting her peak, nearly 7,000 points, to an unprecedented level. Importantly though, 2008, she broke her ankle in a minor heptathlon before the Beijing Olympics and didn't go. And one of the things that meant for Jess, and particularly for me, was that we were exploring all sorts of different types of training. She couldn't load her ankle. And it meant that we were trying bike training, we were aqua jogging, we were doing cross training, all sorts of different types of training. That meant that Jess knew that she was able to use those confidently and make progress, because she won the following year. Something's stuck, here we go. So 2009, Jess wins the World Championships in Berlin, and we get together as a team and we celebrate the win. And it was a lovely evening. Jess treated us to, I think it was a curry actually, in Sheffield. It was great. And I sat next to Jess, and up until that point, so I've been working with her for 5 years. Up until that point, it was relatively relaxed. I got to know her very well, but a lot of it was the science work. I knew a lot about her life, but I had a conversation with Jess in 2009, which I said, what's the dream? What's the hope? What's the ambition? And she said something that was actually quite remarkable, because so many elite athletes are just, I just want to win. Just want to win, and that's it. And it feels like relief. Well, for Jess, she said something that just threw me off guard. She said, well, I want to win in London. But then, you know what? I probably just retire and just, I just want to have children. And well, I was a bit like, not many athletes have got that sense and reason and groundedness. They're normally like, let's just do more. And Jess was very much, I just want to tick my kind of sporting goals off and then live my life. And that sense of perspective and groundedness is the very heart of who Jess is. So we team to get togethers are really important to be able to lever these sorts of conversations. We probably wouldn't have had those sorts of conversations if we hadn't been in a completely different environment, a sort of a social setting. And it was the first mention of the baby word. And I said to Tony afterwards, you know, she's probably going to have a baby after 2012, and that might be it. And he said, yeah, I know, she's told me. So Jess was prepared to have that conversation. The coach was open. It wasn't just completely wedded to trying to keep her going as long as possible as an athlete. So the team post-London were in a bit of limbo. We knew this was on the cards. The press made it a bit of an, it's a surprise, unexpected pregnancy. We were expecting this to happen. And post-2012, sure enough, that we were waiting. And there was just no word whether Jess was going to be coming back. And then we had the announcement. So for us, late November 2013, so she trained loosely after 2012, but late 2013, we start having the first discussions. Jess is about 6 weeks pregnant, so really early in the conversations. December 2013, we start having much more in-depth discussions. The idea is put on the table, okay, how might this go? What are the things that we need to be considering to support Jess? And I'll keep going. So the pregnancy was announced a few months later, January 2014, and Reggie was born in July 2014. Those are the timescales that we were working to. So we get together as a team. We have virtual meetings. We get together as a group. And Tony is, okay, what are we going to do, team? How are we going to support Jess through this process? And actually, we probably got a bit wound up into the details of, okay, well, the relaxin hormone is going to be high, so that's going to be affecting ligament elasticity. We're going to need to make sure we're programming this way, programming that way. And so we got drawn right into the details of thinking how we can support Jess through her pregnancy. And I have to credit the doc. This is Richard Higgins, who was Jess's doctor, the team medic. And he sort of sat back and said, right, guys and girls, I'll tell you what the biggest priority is. And we were thinking he was going to come up with a medical notion. And he said, the most important thing here is that Jess has a healthy and happy birth. And we all felt a little bit, oh, I was thinking about her hormonal response affecting her ligaments around her sacrum and into the detail. And it was such a useful perspective of just thinking, think big picture, think broad here, and think about the wellness of the person first and foremost. So credit to the doc for that. So a few guiding principles that we applied. We tried to preserve running as long as possible. There's an impact aspect of that that means that, that Jess is able to keep the impact, which stimulates the bones, it stimulates the ligaments and nervous system, and it's extraordinarily good for the cardiovascular system. But only as long as comfortable. It wasn't as long as possible, it's only as long as comfortable. For Jess to continue to maintain her strength-based work. So Jess was in the gym regularly with the bump. Started to proactively reduce core work, specific core work. So running as long as comfortable, when she starts saying, I'm a bit uncomfortable running repetitions now or efforts, we started to wind it back. But we were proactively doing that with core work. And so specific core exercises challenges the abdominal musculature in one way. But there's lots of whole body exercises. If you're involving your legs and your arms simultaneously, forces will go through the spine and the abdomen. And so using whole body work in a different way. Jess was very comfortable and familiar with bike work. And that was the bread and butter of us helping Jess train. But she couldn't go on the bike very much because bump gets in the way with the legs. So we swapped out for a cross trainer. We suggested swimming, we suggested doing some aqua jogging type work. Jess wasn't a fan of it, so she just chose not to. She went with something that she was relatively comfortable with. Some other principles, we tried to provide as much structure for Jess to maintain her motivation through it, because always as part of this was the uncertainty as to whether she would come back, but to enhance her ability to come back, we wanted to make sure that we were saying, this week we're focusing on this week we're focusing on that, and provide her with that structure that draws people along through a program. Just in the same way that if you were entering a triathlon or a 5K run, you might follow a program that just enhances your adherence. Importantly though, and there's several different ways in which athletes focus. Some are immersed, some are embedded in the decision making. Jess tended to like to defer most things to the team and to Tony. What am I doing today? Why am I doing that? Okay, let's get on with it. And if Tony said, I want you to do an extra rep, or I want you to stop doing a rep, then Jess would go, fine, it's up to you. But we needed Jess much more involved in the decision making because things were changing. Things were subtly different for Jess. And that meant that she was experiencing things that we'd never experienced before, and she needed to be proactive in communicating that. So we reduced the focus on times, pace, speed, those markers of what she could do. But we switched the focus to perception of effort. How did that feel? So don't tell us what the clock was saying. Tell us how you feel. And that being the source of information as to whether we do a little bit less, we do a little bit more. But one thing was important was that sometimes I would give them advice and say, this is the plan, and they would go off and do it. Whereas Tony, day to day, was working with Jess. And rather than phoning me up and asking me my advice, is that I said, you need to make these decisions in the moment and feel the process along the way. So it's an educational aspect for Tony to take responsibility for this. Fast forward, so this is July 2014, baby Reggie is born. And and he's a cheeky little monkey. He's a lovely little kid. And then we start to turn the attentions to getting back into it. And we'd allowed sort of a 3-month window to say, let's just stay quite relaxed and chilled out about this. Let's not put too much expectations. But I get a call from Jess relatively early and says, what can I do? So she's got Reggie and he's a bundle of joy and energy, but she's saying, what can I do? I want to get active. And so I suggest just walking. So just get the movements going again. Walking is such an undervalued exercise a lot of the time, of simply reactivating the whole body. So there's pram walks, there's leisurely walks, and then she starts to speed walk a little bit. She's starting to improve the sort of demand on the cardiovascular system. Only after a couple of weeks, so she's relatively early, she's felt like she could go for a jog. It's just after a few weeks. But the important word here is felt. She felt that she could. There was no sense of, right, you should be jogging by 2 weeks. It was her feeling of, I think I can probably have a go at this. She started to proactively do yoga, some Pilates, some general movement, which then built into some light body exercises and started to develop some strength again. So non-loaded structured training started to come back in. Again, we went with the cross trainer as alongside jogging. So we're starting small, subtle changes that starts to build loading back up again. And important though, wasn't just what she did, it was how she did it. So this was an importance of, well, just give it a go. If it means that you get dressed for a run and you do 200 meters and you end up coming back, that is the best way of doing it. Try it, give it a go. If it doesn't work, then we can discuss that and make some tweaks. If she's frustrated thinking, oh, I wanted to go for a run, then we can give her something else to be doing. And that could be a cross trainer or something low. Any changes that we made were really small. And when she had energy and said, I think I'm ready to get back into training again, rather than making a big leap, we said, no, we're going to just ease you in back into it. But Tony was critical because not all the team members are with Jess all the time. He needed to lead this out. One of the best things that Tony did, and I don't know what your version of this might be in different situations, was reframe. So Tony said, because Jess was thinking, right, I'm starting to hit numbers in the gym. I'm starting to see times on my training now. I'm starting to realize I'm not doing what I used to do. And Tony reframed. He said, right, here's the book of all your PBs and records and previous training. And that's going in the drawer. That was Jessica Ennis. And there's this lovely sort of stepping moment of once she got married and she became Jessica Ennis Hill, he said, these are Jessica Ennis Hill's new PBs and records. And that was a lovely reframe that meant that she was seeing continuous improvement from baby Jessica Ennis Hill and seeing those improvements, as opposed to comparing to what I previously did when I was at my absolute peak at the Olympic Games. So credit to Tony for reframing in that way. Physically, there was a few big differences. So Jess is this super resilient, powerful, bouncy creature. She hits the floor, and it's just like an explosion. She's able to leap and produce enormous, what's called impulse and power off the floor. So Jess is a resilient creature. That all went. So the relaxing, the ligaments, the structure that allows her to produce this force was just a lot looser. So that all goes. What Jess was able to do though was absolutely eat into the endurance work. So specifically there, baby fetal hemoglobin robs oxygen from the mother. It's basically saying, I'm getting what I want and you're gonna have to suffer. But the woman will put in place a whole load of her own oxygen transport system to allow her to keep going. And Jess came out of the pregnancy supercharged with a cardiovascular system. She was, well, I've almost had like an altitude training camp because someone's robbing me of oxygen during this time. So the balance of training meant that Jess didn't have to put nearly as much effort and focus, and therefore we reduced the training on endurance. And so we were focused on nurturing slowly but surely her strength-based qualities, which are so critical to heptathlon. Perhaps the most profound perspective that Jess talked to us about was, because we were all gnawing on some of the detail and the plan, is I'm a mum first and foremost now. And so this example that I gave you, where Jess has, I've distributed her program that has meant that she's training in the morning, she's training in the afternoon, she's resting, she's recovering, she's getting the optimum response. Jess sort of threw that back to us to say, I'm not doing that anymore because I'm a mum first and foremost. And so we had to reconfigure this training program to allow Jess to train in the morning. And then she said, look, I'm with my son in the afternoon. Yeah, I know it's not optimal. You go and figure it out and come up with some other great ideas that mean that I get to improve anyway. So that was a really important perspective for us to prioritize her focus and prioritize her priority. So surprisingly, and I say surprisingly for a couple of reasons. So Jess was world champion in 2015. She had a baby 13 months before. So she became world champion again. And that was a bit of a surprise because she came back steady, slowly but surely. And these small changes meant that she stayed injury free. She was able to continue with her training because we were taking a little bit more care with her training, which gave her the confidence to think, I'm going to go to Rio and try and retain my Olympic title. And Jess didn't. Jess won a silver medal at the Rio Olympics. But she was proactive in communicating, I'm a mum first and foremost. There were images of her pram next to the training set up. Andy, her husband, was in full support. And she, I would say, perhaps I would agree with Oliver Holt, the journalist, who said Jessica Ennis-Hill burnished her reputation more in defeat last night than in many a victory. A great example of a human being with class, showing that I'm doing this well, I'm going to try, but I'm a mum first and foremost. And if it works out, it works out. If it doesn't, I've tried. Just to wrap up with some final thoughts. This was perhaps the most profound perspective that helped us support Jess in the right way during her pregnancy. But that was the most important thing. And it meant that we weren't just trying to over calculate something that is so unpredictable. Things do change, the body and the priorities do change. And the part of the support was readying and helping support Jess through that process and understanding what is likely to happen and how she might change. Managing expectations, that reframe from Jessica Ennis to Jessica Ennis-Hill, was absolutely critical. But to be staying open-minded as to what might come up and how this might go. But critically making small changes. If there's a recipe for disaster for most elite athletes, it's making a sudden change. As I said, have a look at Jessica Ennis, Jenis Fitness, enormous resource there for people. And she's got some incredible training programs on there. Have a listen to the podcast because Jess is quite frank in discussing how it felt for her from her perspective. And lastly, I'd plug my other half. This is Rachel Ingham. This is my better half, co-director of Supporting Champions, but also runs a coaching system. And if anybody does have any thoughts and needs about transition, Rachel specializes in this particular area around personal coaching through transition, very much the inspiration for her coaching work. I say last but not least, but there's a couple of other resources, Support Champions podcast. We've also got an applied sports science practitioner program coming up. And if anybody of you who are thinking about becoming nutritionists, psychologists, strength and conditioning coaches, performance analysts or physiologists, then we have a program that will enable people to support you to real success. But thanks for your attention.
Amazing. Thank you so much, Steve. Just your generosity in the information you've been able to give us is just extraordinary. And I was saying earlier, I'm going to say it now, Steve comes with a warning, because the last time I spoke to him, I didn't get sleep till 2 o'clock in the morning because I was so like, oh, so many ideas, and so inspired. We have got a couple of questions, and we've got a little bit of time for that. Patsy is asking, would have you ever provided advice to independent dance companies that have heavy touring schedules? So Steve and I have talked about this before in terms of the comparison of physical load. Injuries, early burnout can be an issue here with travel, rehearsals, performance, nutrition and lack of rest. Quite the opposite, I think, of what you've described. Training with Jess. Tell us if you've got any thoughts around that, or if you've ever had to do that.
No, I haven't. But I'm already starting to sort of, I've had some of the conversations. I mean, Lucy and I, we do some work with the Royal Ballet in advising and supporting their support team. But there is a huge demand to be able to do that. And so then we've got to think about what goes into the preparation initially for that, maybe coping mechanisms. It could well be that on tour, people have to be a little bit more systematic and rigorous around some of their nutrition, their sleeping, their resting, type of support services that people can provide to them. There will be a formula, there will be an optimum set of conditions that mean that you take the normal demand of touring and you're able to support people. That means that people are going to have more energy. They're going to be able to focus at a higher level. They're able to recover. So an example would be, this is a little bit detailed, but go with it. So has anyone heard of ice baths? Have anyone seen them in the press where people are plunging themselves into cold water to facilitate recovery?
Yes.
Without boring you on this one too much, there is a reasonable and probably quite a strong hypothesis that they do not enhance recovery. They get you back to where you were, but they actually blunt adaptation. So training, physical movement, your dance training, that's a mechanical, metabolic and neural stimulus. That sounds really cold, doesn't it? That's what it is. It trains those systems. But ultimately from that, you want to improve. You want to make some improvements, some adaptation. So the evidence for ice baths is that it might actually get you back to normal. So it might enhance recovery back to normal, but it doesn't allow you to restore and build new systems in place. It's a bit of a hot topic. So if I'm working with Jess and we're 5 years out, 7 years out, and she's saying, I've heard about ice baths, and I'm saying, no, don't do it, because we need you to improve as much as possible over the next 5 to 7 years. However, in competition, I'm not interested in new fitness. And so ice baths are very much back in. So this is an example where, say, a football team might play Saturday to Saturday. We don't use ice baths. But if they've got a Tuesday, a Friday, and a Monday game where the recovery is much more compressed, recovery's back in. And so you would throw the kitchen sink at them. You would do everything from nutrition, recovery, recovery garments like compression stockings and so on, and so when you're maintaining performance, using recovery systems is really helpful. When you're trying to build performance or build the capacity, you probably need to avoid it actually, and actually make things a little bit harder, without sounding like an old cliche of you know, you've got to be tough enough and feel the burn, all those sorts of things. But they're true. You've got to get the body to respond. I hope that's a great question. I hope that answers your question, Patsy.
Yeah, a really great question. Oh, P has got a question. Jessica sustained an injury in regards to her ankle and then years later had her first child. How would you go about helping someone rebuild their confidence following these big life events, as well as their fitness levels, and as both obviously could be impacted on a similar level?
Oh, that's a big question. That's got so many tangents to it. So the perspective of Jessica Ennis versus Jessica Ennis Hill was probably at the heart of focusing on what you can do. What can you do? So for Jess, she's missed the Olympics in 2008. She's down. She's in tears. I'm sitting there thinking, I was supposed to be talking about training, but I'm now counselling, or I'm now there at a pastoral empathic role, and that takes time to get over that. There's lots of perspectives that can really help. One is focusing on what you can do, what's available in front of me that I can take control for. And so often when someone gets injured, some of the physiotherapy that they often receive just provides them with some structure. I've got to go and see the physio at 10 instead of going training. At 12 o'clock, I've got to ice my leg instead of doing some extra core work or whatever it might be. It's always a great chance to develop weak spots. So when people are injured, they're like, just give me stuff to do. And so you can cover off a lot of the weak spots. And that then means that you're going, you're being smart about this now. You're now coming back stronger. We will use another couple of perspectives. One, that the work that you're doing now to recover from this injury is probably better than any other perspective in the world. And any other athlete who's injured in a similar way, you're doing it better because you're engaged in it. The last one I'd mention, Pia, because this is quite a large topic, is that it's delusional to think that Olympic champions are all these super confident people. They're not necessarily. It was one of the first things I really was surprised about going working with Steve Redgrave and Matt Pinson. I was looking around, well, they're all giants, so I'm looking up here and I'm thinking, where's the confidence? I thought they're all just going to be like, we're just champions, and they're saying, I'm not sure I can do it. I'm worried, I'm concerned. There's a level of worry. We are all hardwired for reward and threat. So we're worried about things. We're also chasing things. The difference that champions take on is they see the threats, but they do something about it. Rather than thinking, I'm worried and therefore I can't do anything, they say, I'm worried about these things. This thing is the one that I'm worried about most, and therefore I'm going to do this. And what that gives them is authentic confidence, because I've done everything I can to work on my performance, my preparation, or the transition that you're working through. So that gives you agency. I'm working on these things, and that builds confidence that's real.
Brilliant. Look, we're nearly out of time, but there's a quick one.
Yeah.
The lovely Kerry Biggin says, would you recommend another recovery tool instead of ice baths?
Is that because they're a bit cold, Kerry? So you don't, first of all, you don't need to make them that cold. So it's about sea temperature. 15 degrees is about optimum. Most people try and get in an ice block because they think colder is better, and that's not the case. There's some evidence that compression garments have an improved ability to return the muscle to normal. But again, there's evidence that they might take away from adaptation. There's evidence also that antioxidants and tart cherry juice is very high in flavonoids and antioxidants that, again, that can enhance your ability to recover. The one thing I would say, though, is if you're interested in adaptation, it comes down to really boring fundamentals of quality rest and recovery. So doing nothing, putting your feet up, getting quality sleep, getting quality nutrition and hydration. So doing the basics really well. It's no magic formula. The difference that a lot of elite athletes demonstrate is they do them meticulously, rather than thinking, just not gonna bother, because they require a bit of discipline. I hope that answers your question, Kerry.
And talking of discipline, I'm going to try and stick to time. Crikey. I know there are other couple of questions, but hopefully I can direct you to some resources or help out with those. Steve, I think on behalf of all of us, just a great big thank you for imparting all of this wisdom, all of this knowledge. And I think all of us are kind of straight away thinking, how can we apply all of those things across the physiological things and the psychological things into our own practice immediately, as well as, I suppose, reassuring the group that there's me, there's people like Chloe Hillier in the room, Adele Quinn, who'll be watching in the future. There's lots of us who are also working in front and behind of the scenes to try and improve information to you and research and all of those sorts of things, that hopefully we can emulate some of those amazing best practices and principles in our own sector. But on behalf of everyone, Steve, I just want to say a big thank you. Come off mute to give him a clap. Amazing.
Thank you so much. Well, all the best to you, but keep it simple.